In this episode, we'll dive into the mysteries of a remarkable artifact pulled from the depths of the Black Sea, poised to reshape our understanding of history. Explore the intriguing links between the Egyptian and Sumerian civilizations and the ancient denizens of the Black Sea shores. Unearth the earliest traces of proto-writing, the unearthing of the world's oldest processed gold, and hints of the first European state, all unfolding millennia before Sumer. Buckle up and get ready for an exhilarating journey through time with us. In 1984, a significant international scientific expedition, named Atlantis, embarked on deep-sea explorations in both the Mediterranean Sea and the Atlantic Ocean. Their focus was on the region known as the Horseshoe between Spain, Portugal, and Morocco. Among the expedition members was Bulgarian scientist and Captain Professor Petko Dimitrov, who, alongside his colleagues, engaged in numerous dives with the Russian submarine Argus at a depth of 130 meters. The scientists had initially speculated about the potential discovery of human-made objects on the ocean floor. While the expedition itself did not yield the anticipated success, it sparked an idea to shift the research focus to the Black Sea and meticulously map the former shores of the freshwater lake before its transformation into the current Black Sea. During the 1980s, Bulgarian scientists made a groundbreaking discovery as they identified the ancient shores of the Black Sea, situated between depths of 90 and 120 meters. This landmass extended 65 kilometers east of the city of Varna, encompassing the ancient bed of the Provadiska River. Over 8,000 years ago, the Black Sea existed as a freshwater lake, characterized by muddy areas with fertile sediments conducive to agriculture. These natural conditions played a pivotal role in the early development of the first cultivated agriculture. The deluge in the Black Sea stands as an undeniable geological event. Its aftermath includes the formation of catastrophic organogenic depressions in the deep-sea Black Sea basin and the occurrence of hydrogen sulfide contamination. Additionally, evidence points to the presence of an ancient shoreline in the basin, situated at contemporary depths of 90, 120 meters, with an age exceeding 8,000 years. This combination of geological phenomena serves as a profound testament to the transformative impact of the deluge, leaving enduring imprints on the Black Sea's geological history. A year after the Atlantis expedition, Professor Petko Dimitrov drafted a project for a new expedition. In 1985, the expedition became a reality. Under his guidance, the submarine Argus and the ship Rift set to work, this time in the Black Sea.
On July 16th, we descended into the paleo channel of the Provadiska River, which used to flow into the ancient freshwater lake of the Black Sea, crossing the entire shelf. There, on the old shores, I came across outlines of holes at around 95 meters. These were two rows, symmetrically arranged. It was clear that this was a result of human hands. Moving further inland, about 300, 400 meters from the old shores, I also found the so-called Noah's Plate. Yes, this is the first and only artifact, but also highly contested by many researchers. We believed then that we had stumbled upon either a tilted settlement on the lake's shore or an ancient harbor and necropolis. This was the only item we took at that time, and we called it Noah's Plate. Later it was discovered that it bears written signs. We doubted that it was one of the oldest writings, existing before the flood, before the influx of ocean waters during the rupture of the Bosporus threshold, about 8,500 years ago,
says Professor Dimitrov. The plate was sent for analysis to several laboratories, but none of them could identify a material analog. Eventually, specialists expressed the opinion that it predates the deluge. The mysterious signs carved on its outer surface also play a role in their conclusion. They resemble the cuneiform writing used by the Assyrians and Babylonians. Photos of Noah's plate have been circulated on the internet, and scholars from around the world have begun to scratch their heads over this ancient discovery. Italian underwater archaeology expert, Professor Francesco Trope, writes to Professor Dimitrov that the signs on the plate resemble Proto-Sumerian cuneiform writing, but this would mean that the people living near the shores of Varna had a connection to the later developed Sumerian civilization, or even laid its foundations. The plate itself has a diameter of 34 cm, a height of 9 cm, and a bottom seat of 21 cm. On the outer surface of the cone and the outer part of the bottom, there are signs carved with precision. It represents a very fine and highly symmetrical craftsmanship. In 2000, Bono Shkodrov compares the symbols on Noah's plate with other ancient signs found on the Balkan Peninsula and the first officially recognized scripts, discovering numerous correspondences. His meticulous analysis involves a comparative study of the signs, drawing connections between the symbols found on the plate and those identified in various archaeological contexts across the Balkans. Certain scholars in the field of ancient scripts argue that the development of the Egyptian script might have been influenced by the Sumerian script. Alternative perspectives propose that the Sumerians adopted their writing system from a pre-existing cultural context. Furthermore, it raises the question of whether, in examining both ancient civilizations, Egypt and Sumer, we should also consider the existence of an older Black Sea civilization around the shores of the former freshwater lake. The enigma surrounding Noah's plate sparked intense debate among scholars, archaeologists, and historians. Some scientists in Bulgaria question its authenticity due to difficulties in dating, but others found a way to connect the plate with something that is already dated: the oldest processed gold treasury in the world. The most significant discovery related to the development of the Danube Black Sea civilization is the finding of the Varna Chalcolithic necropolis. Discovered by chance during construction work in 1972 in the city of Varna, 500 meters north of Lake Varna, some graves were exceptionally rich, while others contained only small objects placed around the skeletons. This indicates a highly organized society with distinct professional and social groups. One of the most notable aspects of the Varna Chalcolithic necropolis is that it is not merely Indo-European, but also the oldest Indo-European necropolis discovered in the world to date. The gold artifacts unearthed in the necropolis so far total over 3,000 pieces, weighing a combined 6 kilo. This quantity surpasses several times all the gold from this era found on the planet, including in Egypt and Mesopotamia. The Varna necropolis dates back to the Copper Stone Age, Chalcolithic, and is dated from 4550 to 4350 BCE. Discoveries in this necropolis precede those in Egypt and the Middle East, revealing that one of the oldest advanced human civilizations existed in the area of present-day Varna. The finds from the Varna Chalcolithic necropolis are believed to be the oldest technologically processed gold in Europe and the world. A bit further north along the Black Sea, the Durenkulak complex, dating from the same period, is the creation of the oldest settled farming population on the continent, responsible for the first stone streets and structures in Europe. All indications point to the inhabitants of the northwestern Black Sea being a highly developed community and possibly the oldest civilization in Europe. According to the evidence discovered so far, this civilization mysteriously disappeared at the end of the 5th millennium BCE. Some researchers attribute this disappearance to an invasion of tribes from the north, while others suggest something much more ominous: a flood. Bulgarian scholar and expert mathematician, author of numerous books and publications, Professor Hristo Smolenov, has been researching the treasure from the Varna necropolis for over 30 years. He conducted a series of measurements on both the objects from the Varna necropolis and the Noah's plate. It turns out that the carved sandstone dish corresponds to standards encoded in the world's oldest processed gold. In the proportions of this mysterious artifact, we discover a clearly defined golden ratio. The ratio between the radii, or diameters, of the plate itself and its base is precisely 5 to 3, 34 centimeters to 21 centimeters. These are consecutive numbers from the Fibonacci sequence. Even if this were a coincidence, it turns out to be not the only one. The base of Noah's plate is perfectly preserved. The radius of the circle described around it is exactly equal to the sum of the lengths of the large and small golden bulls, the emblematic figures from the famous Varna necropolis. The figures of the large and small golden bulls themselves are also in a ratio equal to the golden ratio. The radius of Noah's plate is as large as the large gold plate from the Varna necropolis. This might serve as compelling evidence linking Noah's plate to the same historical period when this civilization thrived, dating back to at least 4500 BCE. Professor Smolenov manages to find exceptionally similar patterns in many of the items found in the necropolis. He mathematically proves that the large gold plate found in one of the graves and the two golden bulls served as a standard for length, a standard that has been preserved for thousands of years and was used in the construction of the pyramids in Egypt. The width of the golden plate in Varna is exactly 1/4 of the royal cubit, and the length is 1/3 of the Nippur cubit. Most likely, the plate itself served as a reel for measuring precise distances. It was later transferred and used in the ancient constructions in Mesopotamia and Egypt. The correspondences continue and become even more intriguing and irrefutable when examining the other objects from the treasure of the ancient people who inhabited the shores of the freshwater lake. In the following videos, we will explore these incredible mathematical proportions encoded in the objects from the Varna necropolis. What do you think about these claims? Are they just coincidences? Or was there an ancient standard of length applied and transmitted over thousands of years? In the upcoming videos, I will talk about more of these incredible patterns or coincidences. The Sumerian culture, as showcased in numerous museums, bears a striking resemblance to the Danube-Black Sea culture. In the Neolithic settlement of Çatalhöyük in Turkey, Anatolia, considered one of the earliest settlements, identical vessels, ceramics, and statues of the mother goddess and the thinker were discovered. Another example is the hall dedicated to the Sumerian queen Puabi in the British Museum. Also known as Shubad or Shudiad, she played a crucial role in the Sumerian city of Ur during the first dynasty of Ur, c. 2600 BCE. The extensive grave goods uncovered in Puabi's tomb, including a gold treasure, closely resemble those found in the richest graves in Varna. However, the Varna gold predates it by thousands of years. A notable artifact is a stone slab with an engraved world map. In its upper corner, next to the arrow pointing northwest, the direction of the Sumerians' primordial land, the place from which our ancestors came, is indicated. It is believed to be the oldest map, pointing towards the northwest, the Balkan Peninsula, and the sacred Hem-Madara Mountain. In Bulgaria, there is a mountain named Hemus, Stara Planina, and a sacred place in this mountain near a village called Madara, close to the reserves of the medieval Bulgarian capitals, Pliska and Preslav. Another sign of advanced civilization in the Black Sea region is the saltworks in Pravadia, just 50 kilometers west of Varna. It is the oldest salt mining and urban center in Europe, 5600-4350 BCE, using a technology still in use today, evaporation of salt water in ceramic vessels. The production was traded to the south, reaching as far as the Aegean Sea. Around 4700-4300 BCE, salt production reached industrial quantities. During a single loading of a pit adapted for salt extraction, about 4-5 tons of salt were obtained. The trade of this essential product, without which life for both humans and animals would be impossible, made the inhabitants of the ancient city among the wealthiest in Europe. The shocking discoveries don't end here. 250 kilometers to the west, in Stara Zagora, during random excavation, works near an ancient burial mound, the remains of a unique burnt house have been found, turning out to be the oldest Neolithic structure in Europe. Inside, the richest inventory from the early Neolithic period was discovered. The house, consisting of two floors, is approximately dated to 5600 BCE. Scientists believe that this house was planned and constructed with skills not attributed to primitive people believed to have lived during that period. Adjacent to this discovery, other two-story houses were found and examined, containing between 50 and 80 ceramic vessels. These vessels were likely used for grain storage, statues, and even tiles with symbols, including one resembling the swastika. In one of the layers, grain was found, providing a dating reference for the house. It is believed that each house accommodated a separate family with their children and possessions. Among the intriguing findings are a clay sphinx figure dating back 3,000 years before its counterpart in Egypt, a clay vase with 360 squares presumed to function as an ancient calendar, and a large storage jar. Interestingly, the proportions in crafting these vessels are identical to those in the Varna necropolis's golden treasure. The golden ratio is observed in many places, and the large storage jar, used for grain, has the same sacred proportions and an identical opening diameter to that of the Noah's Ark plate, found by Petko Dimitrov. Numerous figurines of the Mother Goddess were found, similar to those discovered in the Black Sea region and the Neolithic settlement of Çatalhöyük in Turkey. Many of these figures have specific shapes and resonate at certain frequencies. In the same burial mound near this house, a furnace was found where copper ore was melted. In the same region, mines were discovered from which they extracted this copper ore. Here, one might wonder if there was a connection between the ancient civilization in these lands and Atlantis. The strategic resource for the mythical continent was copper, and 7,000 to 8,000 years ago, only in 11 mines near Stara Zagora, 1,000 tons of pure copper were obtained. This was accomplished with an exceptional labor organization. In Europe, this is the largest copper deposit from that period. The mysterious caste of people managed to transform stones into metal, passing through all the colors of the rainbow. Plato also wrote that the Atlanteans were mainly engaged in copper mining. Whether there were descendants or carriers of their knowledge in these lands today can only be speculated.
The copper mining in these lands was much higher, as there are still unexplored mines. The claim that almost 1,000 tons of copper were obtained is based solely on the 11 discovered mines,
says the archaeologist from the Stara Zagora Historical Museum, Petar Kalchev.
Research shows that about 3,500 people worked in one shift, entirely organized. Each performed a strictly specialized task. The copper was extracted in open pit mines. Where the ancient people, 7,000 years ago, knew they could extract copper from the rocks in the forests, remains a mystery. They followed the copper vein, using a technology applied today with modern techniques, heating the rock with fire, then pouring it with water from the nearby river. The rapid temperature change caused cracks, and the workers started digging into them with tools made of horns, stone hammers, and copper picks. They crushed the rock, then separated the ore and carried it to nearby settlements. There, the smelting of copper began. People who dealt with processing copper ore probably lived in closed communities. They were considered people with supernatural powers who could turn stone into metal. When smelting copper ore, it changes colors like a rainbow, resulting in 11 colors. Imagine what these people represented for others in that era. This ritual was probably passed down from fathers to sons, and the craft remained enclosed within the community.
According to archaeologists, the labor invested in the mines and the organization closely resemble those in the construction of the Egyptian pyramids, but with thousands of years preceding them. Interestingly, the name of Zagora in Sumerian means homeland. In Sumerian,
Zagora
translates to sacred boundaries of the homeland, and Stara is old in Bulgarian, the old homeland. The name Durankulak comes from the expression
Duranki,
which in Sumerian signifies the place of meeting between the sky, An, and the earth, Ki. In other words, this is a Sumerian phrase that means horizon. One thing is certain, mining and metallurgy served as revolutionary catalysts in the evolution of humanity during prehistoric times. This pivotal era marked the initiation of the division of labor and the emergence of various crafts. In the most advanced regions of the ancient world, a profound socio-economic differentiation took root, accompanied by the rise of priestly and royal authority. By the conclusion of the 5th millennium BCE, the denizens of the area surrounding Varna Bay and Durankalak Lake had attained such a transformative stage. The findings from extensive research on the earliest metallurgical practices provide valuable insights into the genesis of civilization. This is evident in the consolidation of significant cultural blocks during the Late Stone Age and Copper Age, along with the initial indications of writing 1500-2000 years before the established civilizations in Mesopotamia and Egypt. As we immerse ourselves in the enigmas of Stara Zagora, Varna Necropolis, Durankalak, Provadia Solnitsada, and their environs, we not only unearth the technological marvels of yesteryear, but also unravel the intricate tapestry of human civilization. This archaeological journey transports us to an era where the mastery of metal forging symbolized the advent of a new epoch. The discoveries within this region not only challenge our preconceived notions of prehistoric societies, but also beckon us to plunge into the secrets and profound depths of our shared history. This is a quote from the distinguished Japanese archaeologist Prince Mikasa.
This Chalcolithic culture from Varna, known for its magnificent golden artifacts, not only predates the great ancient civilizations of Sumer, Mesopotamia, and Egypt, but also signifies the existence of a ruling class with wealth and authority, adorned with copper weapons and metal artifacts. Social, economic, and technological data confirm the discovery of a new civilization, portraying Varna as the oldest civilization known to humanity. Perhaps even more importantly, unlike any other civilization on the old continent, this one has a clear and direct connection to a preceding and distinctive Neolithic culture.
As we conclude our exploration of the ancient Black Sea civilization, from the echoes of the deluge to Noah's plate, the world's oldest gold treasure, and the remarkable discoveries in Stara Zagora, we stand witness to a narrative that challenges traditional timelines and reveals the depth of our shared human history. If you enjoyed this video, check out the one about the stone forest in Bulgaria near Varna, dating back to 50 million years ago. Thank you for joining us on this captivating adventure.